addition or changes to the agenda?
We have one addition to the agenda, that's an item, request to the board to have a motion to allow us to spend some continued city reserve funds for payroll, and we'll explain that more when we get to that item that's added to the agenda.
Entertain a motion to you.
Mr. President, can you move the bill to the agenda? That's the number?
Second.
Move the second to the first of the agenda. Make the additions as stated. All those in favor, right hand. Vote, same sign, 7-0. Consent agenda is the minutes from the last regular meeting, as well as the financial statements and warrants.
What's being taken about?
Futures.
Okay, that's two.
There's two of them.
Custom.
Custom, yes.
Hello, one's been on the phone.
Your public volunteers, that's been on stuff before. Some, sorry, I'm grabbing a little bit, I don't know, but.
What kind of legal services are not covered by KFP? Martin Law Office?
That's our, since we have something that would require that we call legal works, policy, advice, or something like that. Questions that come up concerning audits, and we have somebody that will sue us or something like that, that's the business.
I move we approve the consent agenda. Second motion.
Been moved and seconded to approve the consent agenda. Any further discussion? All in favor, right hand. Vote, same sign. 7-0. Hatred and comments. Hearing none, we'll move on to the business items. The first item of business is the review of the 2011-12 budget.
Mr. President and Board, I'm going to be using the flow of paramount checks that I have there, so if you are, you can see that adjust the rules.
Carolyn, would you like a glass of water?
Okay.
We gave everybody else water.
Oh. Tom offered all the.
You want some water?
Let's try it with them on. A number of you have been through this process before and seen some of this information, but some of you have not. I think it's always good to review it for everyone. This is part of a much larger Excel spreadsheet work book that is called the School Finance Package. We download it from the state website, and what we end up doing is plugging all of our revenues and expenditures and all those kind of things into it. But everything kind of centers around this one form. It's called Form 150. This is what determines how much funding we receive or are able to spend in our general fund, which is the O6 fund. It's called O6. And it starts out, it's based upon student enrollment. And so what we do is do our best estimate of what number of students we're going to have. And we put that number in. That number actually can be one of three numbers. It could be last year's enrollment number. It can be the current year number, or it can be the high average for the last 3 years. So whichever of those three numbers gives you the best advantage or will produce the greatest funding for you is the one you get to use. In our case, when we have declining enrollment, the three-year average is almost always going to be the best number, the biggest number. So for us, what that ends up being is 320 as an average. Last year we had, at the end of the year, I think we had about 310 students. So you can see that having when you use the average raises the number of students you get to account for funding. That number then you'll see gets added or gets multiplied by what the state funds us with, which for this coming year is going to be $3,780 per student. So that actually is a headcount number of students. But we also get to count additional numbers of kids for various things. For example, if you'll see up there, it's item 4, and it's about line 18 on the Excel sheet. It says estimated low enrollment. The state has a form or a chart that has all of these five decimal place numbers based upon what enrollments are. And ours is just slightly less than 50%. So for every student we have, because we have our smaller school, we actually get to count each of them for almost another half a kid. So you can see when you do the math there, you end up with 152.8 additional kids in terms of our funded count. We also get to count some bilingual funding as well. In years past, that has been a decimal number out to the right. This year, we're estimating to be about 7.9. In years past, it's been like 0.2 or 0.3. And if you recall, we have we're going to have about 13 additional teachers in the building that are certified ESL. And so that's the resulting increase in funding. So we go from what would have been about $1,200, it's going to be close to $35,000 of additional funding. So it definitely pays off to have those folks get their certification. And we continue to try to get some others certified as well. So, moving on down here, this is our estimated weighted vocational. What we do is we estimate how many students we're going to have in a vocational class, and that could be like family and consumer science, it could be in the construction science class, it might be in communications class, something like that. Each of those classes that we have a student in, we get to count that student for a sixth. We take the number of hours the kids are enrolled and divide it by 6, because we have 6 hours in the day. And then they multiply it by 0.5. You can see the whole formula right here. That's going to be the total number of kids divided by 6. So we're estimating somewhere around 30 kids on that number. And I should also say, that's the number of kids in funded classes. We have lots of kids in some introductory vocational classes that might not necessarily be funded. And it could be that we have a lot more kids decide to enroll in these than what we're estimating. We'll just have to see. But initially, that's what we're putting in. And so that gets multiplied by 0.5, so that becomes 2.8 for our vocational funding. That's when we get the vocational. Our estimated weighted at risk, this is the approximate number we're estimating the kids that we have that are for, on free lunch. And again, there's a multiplier for that, and so you get a number of FTE or number of student head count out here. And I should note, you'll see it says 40% there. 40% is the break point. Anything below that just gets regular funding. Anything at 40% or above gets an additional 6%. And so what we always do is we build our budget, we put a number in here that will get us to 40%. We actually only probably had last year maybe around 118 kids, I think, that were free lunch. We were about 10 short. But we go ahead and build the budget this way because if you don't put it in and you end up getting those 10 extra kids, you don't get the 40%. You get the regular percent. So what will happen is if we don't get the 10 kids to do it, we just don't get the extra funding. But we don't lose out on anything we would have deserved to have. But this gives us a shot at getting extra if we do happen to get those. And there's the weighting that comes out for that 7.6, or 7.7. That's the additional 6% weighting on top of that one. Okay. We get weighting for transportation. So we take the number of students that we transport. Any student that lives more than 2.5 miles from school and resides in the district, we get transportation funding for. So we put all those kids and there's a formula for that that kind of works behind the scenes. And so we get funded the equivalent of almost 15 kids for transportation costs, for fuel and driver salaries, things like that. The number of kids that we are transporting has declined significantly, kind of with our enrollment in part. 4 years ago, we were probably transporting, or had to transport, we probably were close to 85 students that were eligible. And this past year, I think we had about 38 students that were eligible. So we're just not transporting as many kids. We don't have as many of them that are eligible for transportation. In part, that's a reflection of the high enrollment we have. And this last one, number 14, this is our special education weighting. This works kind of funny, and I don't know how to explain it anyway except for that. For all of these others, you look at the number of kids you have, or what they give you credit for kids, and that's what's going to be multiplied by 3780. But in this one, the state decides how much money they're going to give you for special ed, and you divide it by 3780, and that's what generates that FTE number. It doesn't matter how many kids we have that are receiving special ed services or anything like that. The formula they use for this has more to do with just the number of total kids we have than have anything to do with the cost of our services that we have or anything like that. It's just based on the number of kids. So they plug that number in, divide it, and then that goes in. So after all of those things are looked at, we get a grand total of all of these out here of 668.7 times. And this is the funding rate for this coming year, 3,780. And to give you some idea of how significantly we've been impacted by the funding cuts, 3 years ago that amount was $4,433. Last year it was $4,012. So even just since last year, it's a big reduction.
Still, the decline in enrollment is what hurts more because it's exponential.
Well, it, It does hurt us. I don't know if I would describe it as necessarily exponential, but it does.
Well, each student counts over and over again. It's not
Yeah, there is a multiplying factor in there for like the low enrollment rate and things like that. But every student still counts the same amount. All of our students count 1.5 times with the low enrollment rating. So, but they do all count the same from that standpoint. So if you lose 5 kids, it's 5 times 1.5 is the equivalent of what you're losing in terms of funding.
It's still meaning they're counting that same student possibly in multiple position places,
right,
whether it's in transportation or vocational or whatever. I mean, it's
some of them, yeah.
Well, we had 320 when we started, and we got 668, so that's
right.
More than double that movement.
So this then becomes, once they take this number times that budget per kid, that's the amount that we can budget. That's the amount that we can budget for our general fund for our Code 6. And I'd remind you that we do have 4 different funds that we operate, 4 different budgets that we operate with. We have the general fund, which is 06, the local option budget, which is 08, and we'll look at that as well. Capital outlay, which is 16, and bond and interest, which is 52?
62.
82. We have anything too. The last one on here requires a little bit of explanation, or maybe a lot. This is the calculation here when 3 years ago they started reducing how much they funded us per student. Remember, it was 44.33 3 years ago. Our local option budget is tied to our general fund. It's a percentage of our general fund. And so if they start reducing the general fund with cuts, that meant that our local option budget was also going to follow it and sink as well. And it was almost like a double hit for schools. And so to protect schools from experiencing that, what they did was they passed legislation that said, okay, for the next, initially they said 3 years, they've now extended it to 4 years. You can calculate for local option budget purposes what your general fund would have been had we not made all the cuts. And so then when you multiply times, if you're going to do 30% of the local option budget, it's based on that old number, not the current number. Would that make sense? What they did was, and this, like I said, it's a little more complicated than just that simple description. Here's what our number is for this year for enrollment. They removed this number, the special ed count, from that. And so they then took that new number, 566.1. They multiplied it times what the old dollar amount was. Went up with that plus the new, that's what the difference number is. And so that's what our general fund would have been this year if we had not had all those reductions. And that is a number that reflects even the decline of enrollment. That's all been factored in. So that particular number doesn't do anything for us here on the Form 50, but when we go to the Form 155, which is the next one, we'll see where that enters in. So, questions about what we're looking at budget-wise for the 06? This is a pretty complicated process, people know that we get funded for the number of kids we have, but I don't think they have a good understanding. People out in the public, that transportation enters into that, and enrollment waiting, and vocational, and all these other things. So It's not just a cut and dry thing. There's a lot of variables in there. So, all right, the Form 155. This is one that shows a local option budget. This maximum that a school district can go to is 30%. And because of that little mathematics thing that I was showing you there at the end, basically every school district in the state is at 30% now. Because if you were to factor in how much they would have been cut, they're all at 30%. This form used to be like a full legal size paper long with all kinds of different calculations and stuff. But because everybody's at 30%, it's now simplified down to this. So here's that number that I was showing you right here. That's what the general fund would have been if the base had not changed. And so this is what our local option budget authority is.
So our valuation of our school district were to increase, it would not increase our operating budget for the school. We would just adjust our mill levy to reflect that, or what?
Well, the mill levy for the general fund is 20 mills, regardless of what our assessed valuation is. If our assessed valuation went up, the 20 mills would generate more money, but we wouldn't get any. That makes sense? I'm going to say it a different way. Our assessed valuation for general fund this year is about $35 million for the school district. And by state statute, 20 mills is what is levied for a general fund. Our assessed valuation here, 20 mills generates a little over $700,000. $700,000 is quite a way short of that $2,500,000 that we're looking at for the general fund. So the difference between, let me just show you.
So we are authorized to raise up to 800 and some thousand, and no more than that, because that would be more than 30%.
That's correct. Of this amount, locally, we only generate about a little over $700,000 from taxes, 20 mills. The difference between that number and 700,000 comes from the state, and it either comes from other school districts that generate more, or from corporate business, revenues, things like that. So we only fund, in our general fund, the 20 mills of taxes only funds about a third of what we have, this dollar amount that we get. On the local option budget, though, that is a different story. It is, for us, it is all locally funded. There are no state funds that we get on this one. So whatever that mill rate is driven, or drives how much that is. So, if our assessed valuation went up dramatically, the mill rate would generate a lot more money that could be spent for that. That is the maximum you can spend.
The 20 mills, is that mandated by the state?
Yes. The mill rate that for this one is what we have, we can do some adjusting on. If we make this number here, that's the maximum. If we make this number smaller, then that means we don't get this amount here. We would get a lesser amount. It would reduce the mill rate, but we would also get less money. So, and when we get, after we get through these different forms, I'll show you, it's called the Code 99, that puts all this stuff into kind of a nice neat package that makes it a little bit easier to look at. So questions about local option budget. As I said, this is all locally funded. That's because in our district, what the state does, they take the assessed valuation, they divide it by the number of students we have, and you end up with a number that's called the assessed valuation per student. They put that into a chart or table that they have, and it determines how much state aid you get. If that assessed valuation per student is above the 81st percentile, you get no state aid. If it's below that, the further below it is, the more state aid you get. There are some school districts that get almost 60% state aid on that number, which means for every dollar that they spend of local option budget, 60 cents of it is paid by the state, and only 40 cents is paid locally. And that's because they have either a lot of kids and not a very high assessed valuation, or they have maybe like the number of kids we have, but they have a little low assessed valuation. For example, Stafford has a much lower assessed valuation than we do. A few less kids than we have, but not dramatically. But they probably get, I think, somewhere between 20 and 25% state aid on the local option budget. And the same thing happens for capital outlay and bond and interest. So
this is the portion of the budget, for example, that neighborhood revitalization applies to, only this portion. If we...
The impact only impacts us, yes. It applies, I think, to the general fund as well, but it doesn't impact us. Because we're going to get whatever that dollar amount, whatever this dollar amount is here, we're going to get that dollar amount regardless of what the neighborhood revitalization does. Because if neighborhood revitalization decreases our assessed valuation, the state's going to make up the difference in funding.
So in other words, we are generating 700 and whatever thousand from the mill levy assessed to
locally. Let me just show you that.
And you're going to make up 103,000 or whatever that is?
Let me just show you the code 99, and that will maybe help you see a little bit better. Okay, this is the code 99. This is what we publish. And it shows all the expenditures by codes and by funds, and it shows historically what they have been. It shows the mill rates. For example, you can see this was actual expenditures. That's for the general fund. There's the codes out there. That's general fund. You can see the mill rate was 20, and last year was 20, and this year it's going to be 20. For our assessed valuation, 20 mills is going to raise $718,080 of that amount right there. So the difference between those two numbers is going to be picked up by the state. The state will actually fund the difference between those two. Right?
So regardless of what your actual assessed valuation is, they're going to pay 30%. They're going to make sure that you get 30% of your budget.
In general fund, they're going to make sure you get all of your budget. In general fund. The 30% only applies to the local option budget. Let me continue on here. So regardless of what this number is, this is what it is for us. There may be some districts that are either so large or so wealthy or something like that, they could have, I'm thinking like Johnson County, for example. Johnson County might have a school budget of $50 million, but 20 mills in Johnson County might generate $150 million. And so the taxes still go to the state, and that's part of what gets redistributed back out to districts that aren't able to generate that. In the local option budget, you can see a different story here. One, you can see the amounts that we've spent historically, and then what we're looking at. You can see what we're proposing for this year is only about 6,000 more than last year. And you can see the mill rates as well. 21.7 generates $822,233. The difference between these two is that we have a cash carryover, or had a balance carryover in local option budget of whatever that difference is, about 48,000 roughly. Because we receive no state aid for that. So that's, this is generated by, that's completely taxed, and the difference between those is just whatever we had as a cash carryover or balance. Our assessed valuation only went up, I think, only like $700-$800. And actually, I can show you that. This was our assessed valuation last year for general fund, and that's for this year. So a little less than $500 there. And for the LOB, again, a little bit less than $500 difference. But you can see it's made some pretty big jumps. When you go back 2 years ago, it jumped almost $4 million right there. Okay, questions about that? That's a lot. I'm throwing a lot of information at you, so please ask questions. Take you now to this is code 16. This is our capital outlay. This shows historically what our unencumbered cash balances have been for the last 3 years. I would make note of the fact that in 2009-2010, in the process of trying to keep the budget relatively level without jumping up dramatically, we did not levy any capital outlay that year. So we had zero revenue levied that year. And so when you look, and revenue always comes in the following year, so that's why this slot right here is blank. We did not have any revenue for it because it was zero this year. what we have proposed last year, our capital outlay was at 2 mills. We're authorized up to 4, but we only ran out of 2 again to try to keep the mill rate from jumping around too much. What we have built this budget on is 3. That would be a place that if when we start getting into discussions and looking at this, if you feel like the mill rate that we're proposing, if you're going to do that, that would be a place that you could adjust and could reduce that. One other thing I would point out, this sometimes, when people see this in the paper, when we look at the Code 99, it will say that we have budgeted that much money. That does not mean that we have that much money in projects budgeted. The way school budgets work is, one, you can only spend money you have, and you cannot spend money you don't have budgeted. So that is the maximum amount that is in our capital outlay budget, based on how we currently have it set up. See here, this is showing you all of the revenues, the resources. If we did not put that large number in there and we had something happen, had a boiler blow up, or lost a couple of roofs or something like that, we would not be able to spend that money unless we came to you and said we need to republish the budget and things like that. So what we do is we put whatever the maximum amount is there, we don't have any intention of spending all that. But we do put that in there so we have the authority to spend it should we have to. We don't have anything even close to projects we're spending. But just so you understand, when you see that, sometimes people will say, gosh, look, I'm going to spend all this huge amount of money. That's simply what is budgeted and not what is intended to spend. Again, this is the capital outlay fund. It's called Code 16. Any questions about any of that? This is where it gets, and this is why Julianne and I were having fun saying numbers back and forth. In our system, bond and interest is code 82. In the state system, it's code 62. Somewhere eons ago, the districts labeled it 82 instead of 62, and the state changed it, I don't know which, but we just continued to roll forward this way. But, this shows the financials for bond and interest. Our bond and interest payments that we have are for the early education building and for the science classroom renovations that we did 6 years ago. And that was a $1.3 million bond. It had been rolled together with a bond that was originally done in 1997, I think for some air conditioning and maybe some windows. The 1997 bond has been retired now for several years, and we're now just paying on this one. The balance that we have, what we have for payments for this coming year, we have interest payments of $25,948. We have a principal payment of $109,000. So this is just how we have to do the funding for that. One of the things that's a little confusing about this is we actually have to have funding. Like, for example, if you look at it right now, that's the amount of money we have right now in the bank. Right here. That's how much we have in the bank right now, $162,043. And you're like, wow, that's a lot. A lot more than what we have to have in payments. But the problem is the payment dates don't correspond with our fiscal year very well. So we're going to have that $190,000 payment come due here in September. We won't get the funding for next year until a year from January. So we're kind of a year behind all the time with our receiving our funds. So we actually have to have almost 2 years worth of funds in there to match up with the schedule. So that's why it looks like that. The nice thing is when we get to the last year of the payments, all of this stuff will be zero. Because we've already had the money in the bank and just made the payment. The board actually, and I talked to the state about this, the board probably will have the option if they would like to pay off those bonds early and maybe save a little bit of interest. So that would be something to look at in about 2 years to see where we're at.
So, what is the maturity of the bond?
2014. I know we have in September this $190,000 payment, and then we have three more payments after that. So it's in September of 2014 is when we pay off. All right, so those are the four main funds we have. The 06, which is the general fund, the 08, which is the local option budget, 16, which is capital outlay, and then this one, 62, which is bond and interest. All of those depending on what, you know, for example, this one, we have to have a certain amount of funding to be able to make those payments every year. So the amount of funding that we have to have adjusts mill rate. And the assessed valuation, this is probably one of the ones where we have the most dramatic impact. I'll show you how this works. Here's our bond and interest. You can see what the mill rate was 2 years ago. And remember, our assessed valuation 2 years ago was $31 million. When this bond issue was originally presented to the public to be approved, to be voted on, that it was proposed that the mill rate would probably run about 9 mills. Well, that was based on what the assessed valuation was, and the assessed valuation has jumped a lot. So the mill rate has gone down a little bit from that. Last year it was at 5.14. Our payments have been increasing a little bit. Last year, I think it was like $180,000. This year it's $190,000. Next year it's $200,000. So the financing has to go up a little bit for that. So that's why you can see a little bit of an increase here. But it's still significantly less than the 9 mils that we originally proposed.
There's not a variable rate on the interest, is it?
No.
So why do you make it go up?
Because the amount of payment increases, the principal we have to pay.
Oh, it's not the increasing. Payment we make, it's just the
yes.
portion that is.
Yeah. The actual payment amount fluctuates. It's not constant the way we had set up. I know that sometimes, like if someone buys a car or a house or something, they set it up so that the interest in the payment works out to be the same amount, but this is not set up that way. Okay, so the bottom line in all this, by state statute, 20 mils is the mill rate for the general fund. The local option budget adjusts based upon what we budget for the local option budget that we feel like we need to spend. So that's 21.72. And again, you can see those have been trending down. You can see here is the mill rate for the capital outlay. That would be one place if the board feels like what we're proposing is not acceptable, we can make some adjustment. I would not recommend going back to zero again, but we could make some adjustment there. And then bond and interest, which again, that's not one that we can adjust, because that's simply covering what our cost is going to be. So, the bottom line is we currently have the budget put together as the mill rate that is proposed for next year would be 51.006. 2 years ago it was 50.705. Last year it was 49.022. So it's up a little bit, a couple, not quite two, from the previous year. And that's what we're proposing. Be open to questions.
On the 3%, what was the thought process behind going from 0 to 3?
Well, actually, from last year to this year, we went from 2 to 3. Last year we had 2. It was 2 years ago that we were at 0.
Scroll down a little bit. One of the things that we've tried to do as a board, you go down a bit here. So show your note. You notice that on line 69 of the Excel spreadsheet there, line 1, we had 50.7, and then last year was 49. The idea is that if we can keep that pretty level, instead of up and down, we're better off. And that varies on what we have on some of the others up above. That's the reason we dropped that down to 0 to keep that in the prior year that was
Well, if we had not dropped this down to zero, it would have been, you can just add, if we'd have had the full 4 mils, it would have been almost 55. Even with 2 mils, it would have been almost 53. So that was, you know, we did not have any significant projects. We added it back in this past year, so I put it both on here. Last year it was actually 2 mils, and you may wonder why it doesn't show 2 mils there. What we do is 2, and then when it gets to the county treasurer and they do whatever their final calculations are in terms of assessed property or property tax or something like that, it can get adjusted. And so this, we set it at 2 mils to get that much money, but it ended up that only 1.891 mils was needed to generate that much money. So that's why that was not 2. But we knew we had some projects that we wanted to do, some concrete work on the north side of the building, we would probably be looking at possibilities, replacing bleachers and some things like that. One of the things I put in there for 3 is we have rapidly aging fleet of Suburbans, so we really need to look at replacing at least one of those. We're going to talk later tonight about buses. We have several buses that are very old that one we just need to get rid of, but also some of the ones we have are starting to have some pretty significant maintenance things, and so that might be enough that we look at as replacing the bus. So that was the thought process behind the 3. But as I said, that is a place where we have some discretion and can make some adjustments. If you think that this much of an increase is from 49.02 to 51.06 is not going to be tolerable for the public.
That 3 mils is only going to make 113,000.
That's correct. It doesn't generate a whole lot.
And last year, 2 mils generated 139,000.
Yeah.
But it doesn't seem right when our assessed valuation has increased.
Mm-hmm. I can look at that, but I can't change the formulas that are in the spreadsheet. Everything is locked. All we do is just put the numbers in. So the only thing that...
Well, that was a figure in assessed valuation.
I'm sorry?
You said our assessed valuation went up.
Yeah.
So just how do you put that in the
spreadsheet? It only went up about $500. I can't explain it. I mean, I saw the same thing. I don't know why. But they couldn't explain it. The state either, so.
That's crazy. You said that we had a bond payment that's coming up. It's due
in September.
Mm-hmm. What's this on in August for the bond principal and interest at $204,000?
Yeah, that's it. It's due in September, but we if you don't pay it.
20 days
in advance, then you get penalized. So it's actually due in September.
Oh, so this is that payment along with the interest. And then what's the UMB loan payment?
That's the last payment on the activity bus. We have at least purchase on that. We had 3 payments on that. This is the last one.
Is that the UMB?
Yes. They did the initial quote for us, but UMB was having a lower percentage interest. It wasn't the UMB at the Hudson, it's UMB at Messenger that does these purchases.
That was the last one on the bill?
Yep. Here's the explanation. This is just occurred to me. This is why this looks funny. These are expenditures. I was thinking of revenues or not. And it is kind of confusing because, like up here, when you see this, it shows you how much it generates. All the rest of these are expenditures. Right here. That's how much we spent out of capital outlay. So you're comparing apples and oranges.
This so we don't really know what to.
I can tell you roughly. In the last couple of years, it's been around $27,000 per mill. I mean, we can do it. It's like 37,000 per mill is what it generates. And to show you how dramatically different that can be in some districts, for example, in Burlington School District, they have Wolf Creek nuclear power plant there. One mill there, I think, generates somewhere around $200,000 in capital outlay. Out in Southwest Kansas, the school district was
burning.
I think it was burning and talked to somebody at some point. I mean, one mill out there generates like $250,000, some outrageous amount. So, and obviously they're a district that they receive no state aid, just like us, but where we might be at the 82nd percentile, they're probably up there pretty close to the 100th percentile. So once you don't get state aid, you're the same as the big fish. So. But that's where some people think that there are things about school funding that aren't fair. Michigan Valley District, they can have fantastic facilities. Burlington, for example, has a baseball stadium that rivals probably most Division II college baseball fields. I mean, it is nice. It kind of looks like that. And if you've been out to the baseball diamond in Denver, it's all done in brick. It looks like that, just smaller. But I mean, it's really fancy. So, anyway, back to primary thing. The question, what I'm wanting discussion from the board is this number here. Can the board live with that, or do we need to tweak that? What I'll be asking you to do at the end of all this is to approve this budget for publication. We then will put this in the paper. It'll publish next Wednesday. It has to publish, we have to have 10 days for people to see it after publication. And then we schedule a hearing, which we're proposing for Monday the 22nd at this point. We can talk about that as well. But we do have to have it all done and wrapped up by August 25th. It has to be done and submitted by that day. So, taking you back to the mill rate that we're proposing. Is that something that seems reasonable, or do you think the public would support?
The only number we have to play with is capital outlay, though.
Yeah, you can play with the local option budget for a little bit if you wanted to. I wouldn't recommend that because that really is operating for salaries and utilities and all that kind of stuff. If we play with capital outlay, delay replacing a suburban or a bus or something like that. Those are not things, those are things that are going to be necessary in the long run but aren't necessary necessarily have to be done next year, but all the salaries and utilities and stuff do, so.
Let's go back to when you first started this conversation about what was it, 2.5 million on the general and, and then the local option budget?
Yes.
And you say the state will make up the difference between
those two.
Then why do we have our local option budget so high? The state's going to make it up.
They only make up the general fund. They don't make up anything on the local option budget for us.
Right.
For some school districts they do,
but for us. Our local option budget was lower, would they still make up the difference? Let's say it was 500,000. Let's say we lowered our mill levy.
Uh-huh.
And it was 500,000. Would they make up the difference still?
On local option budget?
No, on
general fund.
Well, the general fund that's as high as it can go. If you reduce it here, you can't add it on here.
Okay.
And so what would happen is we would have to cut staff and programs and things like that, because these two numbers, I mean, those are fairly hard numbers that we need to have to operate to make salaries and do all the hard costs that we have.
So really what our mill levy is, that the county collects for the school, is 41.7. But we only get to locally really control the 21.
I think the 20 is set by the state.
Is that right? The 20 is set by the state. And, I sort of understand what you're saying. In terms of, if you take the bond and interest out of it, which is the payments, if you take the capital outlay out, which is kind of equipment and roofs and stuff, and just look at the day-to-day operation, 41, almost 42.
Well, if you think about it this way, too, like, when you make out your check, in December and in May, you're not making out anything to the state of Kansas. It's all going to the county. The county is just taking the equivalent of that 20 mil and sending it to the state to redistribute, and the 21.7 stays here in the county the whole time, and we get that payment directly from the treasurer's office.
Yes. Yeah. The way the state distributes it back to us is we get a payment. custody. At this point, indications are that she will be returning at some point, so at least something will happen. And it may seem like, well, why do we have to do this if we're not sure if she's going to leave? Absolutely. We need to look at this as if it was our employee who had the same thing happen. We would still have all the same expenses that we're looking at right now. The fact that we have had this shared agreement is something that's different. It's our intention to follow through on this weekend, that she will be returning at some point. We already have arrangements to put the sub to cover and do that. So. All of this is based upon Stafford's connection there. Obviously, if she can't return and do her duties, then I don't know if you have any of this experience to tell me if she does return.
I move the board approve the shared agreement for facts with Stafford School for 11 and 12 school year.
Second.
Been second to approve the shared services for the facts of TSD 349 for the 2011-12 school year. Any further discussion? All in favor of the right hand? All the same sign? So no. Approval of the library budget.
Christy Snyder is our librarian director, and I'm going to let her present. The interlocal library board met this evening and discussed this. Tom Garner and Bill Milton are both school board representatives on that.
They had a meeting.
And I'll let Christy.
Yes, the process is I present this to the library board, and we take it to you and the local board, and now we get to present it to you. And the column with budget is what I'm proposing, and I've compared it to last year's budget, and the bottom line is it's the same amount as last year. I have a few, my Sickles grant, my South Central Kansas Library grant that we use to pay for salaries in the summer for our clerks has been reduced. Also the state aid, but in talking with Julianne and Dr. Kimberly this afternoon, I was very frugal last year, and I used some grants, and friends in the library helped us buy a lot of books. So we still have $34,000 ready to bring over for this year. And so we're not going to request anything unless we need it. It's so close to what the budget is. So I just kind of shuffled things around where I didn't spend a lot last year, and it turned out about the same. We had Mark, but the district does pay our salaries, and you guys probably discussed this already, but last year we found that Mark was an employee. Even though he works for the IUCA, it's considered that he is a USD 350 employee. So when he works in the evenings for us, it created some overtime for the district. And so the library board is, they agree with me that Mark is a good employee for our staff, and so we just are going to go ahead and pay the over time.
Out of the
Education Foundation.
One of the things I would note, and Christy started getting into this a little bit, we usually work, kind of describe this as being the library operating budget, because it's kind of what it costs to operate the stuff. But it doesn't include any of the staff, or utilities, or insurance, or upkeep, or things like that.
This is basically what I use to purchase materials for the library. And that's what the trust funds were set up for and what's in the Education Foundation. And then I get, from the district, I also get some funding from the 06, the general fund that I use. And the rest of it is down there under income. You can kind of see I broke down what we get. And then above kind of shows you what I'm spending. Yes, we have we have an agreement with the South Central Kansas Library System. The state has a state courier, and I think it's like $1,500. Postage was getting really, really high, and so they decided to do this. So we have a courier come Monday, Wednesday, and Friday evenings to pick up our books, so we don't have to mail them. And what we're talking about is the interlibrary loan system. Kansas State Library has a wonderful, especially for smaller libraries like us. You can't buy everything. You can borrow it from other libraries, and we loan to other libraries as well. So this helps us shuffle them back and forth and save us quite a bit of money. But every once in a while, I have to mail a few. Any more questions?
Mr. President, I would move the board to approve the 2011-2012 library budget.
Second motion.
Discussion. All in favor of approving the 2011-12 library budget, please send them. Right hand. Close same sign. 7-0. Thank you for your
presentation.
Disposal of excess property.
Mr. President and Board, we have two buses that we're proposing that we put the board authorize us to dispose of. One of them is bus 4. It's in its 20th year. We did not use it last year at all. There's a backup. In fact, we didn't use it. I think we could dispose of it. It's basically just insurance to people. The other one is bus 7. Oh, by the way, bus 4 is a small bus. It's only like a 14 passenger bus. Bus 7 is the other one. It also is its 20th year. It is a large, what I would call activity bus. It's what we used to use. Just like our football teams, basketball teams, stuff like that. We've purchased bus 1 4 years ago, and bus 2, both of those are activity room buses. So bus 7, basically, it's not being used either. Like we have used it once last year. So we recommend both of those be disposed of. And we ask permission to list those on the road auction. And then finally, we're in the process of replacing the fence around the practice field.
we have about 100 wind posts and approximately 700 feet of welded wire fencing that we'd like to solicit bids for. We actually already put an ad in the paper, but we'll ask approval of the board to accept whatever the highest bid is that we receive for those. The posts, what's in the ground now probably would not make a good post, but it's a 6-foot fence, so even if you cut off what's on the bottom, you'd make a decent post for a ball ground fence cover. I'll probably put back that in there. So, I believe about 100 of those, and so that's 700 fences. So, we would ask approval to dispose of the 2 buses and also the fencing.
When we sell things like that, where what fund does it
go
back to?
All these funds kind of dispose property goes back to our capital outlay fund.
Does it have to?
Yes.
Not even like a minor foundation fund. I mean, you didn't put it into understanding the limitation on general fund or whatever. Could you put it into foundation fund?
Came out of it, needs to go back into it.
Is what?
I said it came out of that fund, so it needs to go back into
it. Didn't necessarily come out of that fund. I suppose it could have come out. You can, and we have in the past, purchase buses and other types of equipment out of general, but then we sort of have to come out of that, but that's what we go back to. Any property that we dispose of that we receive funding for has to go back to that. So, I don't think we'll watch it for that.
Mr. President, I move that we dispose of the excess property and present a bond administration.
Second.
Moved and second to approve the disposal of excess property as presented by the administration. Any further discussion? All in favor, right hand. Vote same sign, so no. Added agenda items, contingency reserve.
And for the benefit of new board members, we do have a fund that is not one that is generated by any mill rate. It's called the Contingency Reserve Fund. Districts are allowed to transfer money there. Those funds can be used for anything. They can be held and used for any purpose. Usually they're for some sort of catastrophic event or something unforeseen that comes up in the course of the year. 3 years ago, the percentage that you could have in contingency was 6% of your general fund budget. The state, seeing that we were going to be entering into some pretty dire financial situations, passed a law that authorized districts to be able to put up to 10% of the general fund budget. And so, the last couple of years, when we've had a little bit left, we've been able to do better. So we do have 10% in there. That law sunsets this year, and so we have to drop back to 6%. And so one of the ways to do that is in trying to create flexibility, as you were talking about, would be for the board to authorize us to make, for example, we would like to request being able to use contingency to pay our part or maybe all of our September payroll out of contingency. That will reduce it down. We'll have to see what exactly gets us down to 6%. But then that will free up funds in our general fund that toward the end of the year, if we need to transfer some to food service or driver's ed or vocational or special ed or someplace like that, it will give us a lot of flexibility and those additional funds. So that's what we're requesting. Allow us to comply with the law by the end of the school year and gain us the flexibility to do it this month.
My question is there a need to do it before the 1st of January?
No, there's not. We were just trying to do it now just to be friends and what we're working on for the rest of the year. But we wouldn't have to do it.
I know the state revenues are up, so I don't foresee where the funds coming.
No, but we're not looking at it from the shortage standpoint. We're just looking at it from 15-6%. Having that 6% left will still cover us with one left of the day. So it would have to shore us. But like you said, revenues the past month, I think they were up 100 million. Above estimates, so that was a good sign. Whether that will maintain it, we'll have to see. We're going back down.
When do you have to be in service?
By the end of the year.
My experience is don't do it. One day sooner, we'll have to.
What would make it harder to do it later in the year versus doing it?
Wouldn't make it harder, but it makes it easier for us in terms of just as we look at funds and are trying to estimate where we might transfer things to other funds. We were so bad we thought it would be doing it sooner to do it early, we wouldn't know exactly what we were going to
do. So if we did come to a month plan, we needed to use the contingency to pay salaries. That doesn't typically require a resolution, does it?
We did not ever have to do it, so it does take a little to approve the amendments.
Because of the coming out of contingency, or because of the level of money?
Any spending that's coming out of contingency has to have board action.
What do we need to know about the teacher business for the month?
Last year we had said that we thought we might have to, but we didn't know how to do that.
It doesn't matter, but you do things ahead of time, thinking that's the thing to do.
Well, you've got to have it done anyway, so it doesn't make any sense. If you know you're going to have to do it, you might as well do it and be done.
Well, unless they change their mind.
And if they do, what we could do at the end of the year is transfer it back.
As long as you could do that.
Yeah, and we could make the transfer back at the end of the year. But I don't think we're going to ever do that.
Decide whether I want to belong to it or not. I don't know if it's easier for you guys. Kind of like staying, I hate to spend it once they have to. Once you
know.
Well,
you said you can put it out of there.
Yeah,
if you have it, you know you can.
Well, you would, because you hadn't spent it out of general fund.
So, how close are you going to get to that 6%, you think? Have you figured it out? Penciled it out?
We'll have to talk to the state, because once we publish the budget and do all that stuff, we'll send you'll get a copy of it, and they'll basically tell us what the exact amount is. I mean, we can do the band, but we wait to hear from them. So they'll just get that on August 25th, so probably 7 days later. We can estimate it pretty close. We may find that we get down to June, and if our audited budget ends up being a little bit less, we would have to take a little bit more out.
We just need to do anything. Mr. President. I move that the use, I guess, 4% contingency reserve fund for the September salaries. We'll get it down to the 6%, which would be our 4%. So, down to 6%.
Second.
Moved and second to authorize payments out of contingency reserve down to 6% for September salaries. Any discussion? Hearing none, all in favor, right hand. Opposed, same sign, 7-0. Communications.
I had a job that I was supposed to work on, and it was too hot. And I ended up visiting with the people on the chairs and have something to do for next month. But it was too hot to make the trip. So I didn't get up. That's my excuse.
That's pretty good.
Yeah, I thought it was too.
It's too hot to talk. Boy, that is a good
one. It's when you're walking.
What were you supposed to do?
Talk about redoing the chairs and outdooring somebody.
Okay, that all?
Yeah.
It's probably a hot air pun.
Carolyn.
I have nothing new to report.
Barb?
I have nothing new to report. I'm sorry, I missed last month's meeting. Congratulations on the new offices. And I have a new grandson.
Sounds like you got a better deal there.
Yeah, I did. Ryer. Someday he hopes to go to school here if we can find jobs for his parents. So.
Tom?
Bill and I attended the interlocal library meeting earlier this evening. I have some reports. I think this is Christie's report that she does. And I think Bill can help me with the number of this. But I think the biggest thing that they would like to stress is the loss of the elementary librarian. We're talking about a lot of these elementary programs maybe getting put by the wayside. I think they had a volunteer maybe for the Tiger Cox program. But a lot of the other stuff, as far as elementary goes, maybe could suffer because of the lack of elementary librarian. That was one of the biggest things that they had to discuss. We just talked about different activities that the library does. As you can see, it's quite a few. I didn't realize that they did so much stuff. And I didn't realize that the community room, the public is doing the community room. I didn't realize that, but I learned that. There was some other stuff. I think there's going to be some major issues with updating the air conditioning system at some point. That's going to be a big expense. It's going to have to be addressed before. I mean, it's coming. Not only that, but they were concerned with maintenance issues around the building, watering, and making keeping it look nice with the maintenance people that we provide, and sometimes not having any services as far as cleaning services.
You're talking about basically
custodial stuff, yeah.
Mostly on the summer, it's yeah. More of a sketch than anything, making sure we have people covered.
Yeah, the biggest thing was about the librarian for the elementary and said she'd try to see how that worked out. There might be a lot of complaints, so
Isn't very much of a place.
At this point, unless funding is proposed from the state level, we kind of get to the size school district wise. If you just look at it strictly from the school district size, where there's probably not a school district our size has two buildings, but the difference is that we have, it's not just a school library, but this community as well. So that's where the extra stress comes on the staff. So,
well, if you focus here, then it's more than focus on one or so.
Something else Christy was excited about, I think, was being able to geek the library. It's a new term of, I think it's just basically promoting the library.
Yeah.
I think, yeah.
We've turned geek into a verb, something you're passionate about. And so we want you all to geek your library. And then the idea is... The idea is that anything you're passionate about that you geek, you can find information about at the library we can help you with. And it's like Tom hadn't realized we could, the public could use a community room. Well, the first phase is getting people reacquainted with the services of the library and what we do. And then getting them involved and getting them in the building involved in the programming we have, so that in the end you've got some advocates for the library when the state cuts all our funding. We've got somebody who can.
Do you have, this is going to the internet and the social media, do you have a Facebook of your own?
I do.
For the library?
I do.
And your website, is it connected with the school?
The school district, it's on
so
the
you
school.
Don't have
mm-hmm. But I still don't think, and our catalog is online. It's just how do you get the word out. That's what this program is going to help us. And a lot of people, I still have people come in this last week, and where's the card catalog? Well, it's on the computer. You know, it's like, what? You know, it's they're still not the drawers to go through. You know, we're still kind of battling that. So
we have on the website, we call it a widget. It's kind of fun if you have it on the website to see it ties to the library and the library checkout system generates just ongoing numbers.
Yeah, it's actually a Renaissance Learning widget that shows you how many books the kids have read, how many pages they've collectively read. It's
how many millions of words.
And I could, how many billions of words. We could highlight a class each month and see how they're doing, or we could play with a little bit more, but we just found it last year. So yeah, we're trying to do some. You know, the library just isn't a reservoir of books anymore. You really have to, the information is everywhere. So you've got to teach people where it is and how to use it and know you're getting the right information, and that's going to be our emphasis.
Well, you should offer
a snippet of what?
So maybe you should offer classes to people that are scared of the computer.
Yeah.
And
yeah, the problem is staffing. There's just so few of us, it's hard to offer a lot of things, but we're working on it. We're trying to figure out how to do it. We've had some volunteers.
Some teacher's aides over there, some students, high school students.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. But they're only there for an hour.
Yeah.
So, you know.
Mm-hmm. Christy, what are going to be your hours? Coming here.
We're trying to stay even, and what we're open from 8 to 7 Monday through Thursday. Actually, the kids, you know, the schedule changed, so we're really open at 7:30. We don't really advertise it. It's more, you know, that the kids come over at before 8 o'clock most of the time. They're there at the door.
8 to 7 Monday through Thursday, 8 to 5 on Friday. We're closed Saturday. And open Sunday afternoon, 2 to 5. And usually we're open during the holidays, just shortened schedules. So, like during Christmas vacation, it may be 8 to 4, and the weekends will be closed.
The Friends of the Library is a pretty neat thing too. They raise some money to buy some books and materials with that money also. So.
They've got a lot of neat programs going and really help us out quite a bit. You should all join.
Well, last spring when Andrea's group of teachers was here, we talked about community development, and one of the ideas that we discussed was the idea of entrepreneurship training for children, and Christy right away said, don't forget your library, and we are holding that countywide event at the library next week, and it's designed to be something that both utilizes the library, but one of the other nice things is that there's computers there, and the kids can do some research, and the staff has been wonderful and cooperative and having those ready, and so we do have a very versatile library. It's nice.
Cool.
Okay, thanks.
Nothing new to report.
I attended the South Central Cannabis Special Ed Board, and I would say, oh, I am vice chairman down there. I'm glad that Chief Nick will get his mouth shut on me, but I don't care.
You're their director now?
Yeah, Ryan Cunningham's the director. And the assistant director as well. Everything seems to be going pretty smooth. There is a little process of possibly moving all of that in town to the Pratt-closed elementary school at Southwest. One of their elementaries they closed. Mm-hmm. And so it's available for, and they're going to be using it for some special ed projects and so forth. Doing a little bit of remodeling. Because that building they're in is kind of limited, missing a few more size, you know, that could do some things. And everything at Iuka is moving to that elementary school. So,
Zombie will be transferring students from all the way to Pratt instead of just like
currently
on
that student.
So everything seems to be running pretty smooth, and I was real pleased with that meeting, and hopefully it will go that well here. The state, the funding's an issue with them. They do have, you know, it's more of the federal dollars there than the state reimbursement, Medicaid. So I'm glad they've got something pretty sharp. Ryan can be picking up on that. So hopefully we won't have any issues with that. We had some retirement of teachers. We have some replacements. So, other than that, I just got back from the vocational conference and people itself went really well. Everything on the vocational side seems to be going pretty smooth. The sessions I attend were all specific to ag, so, but I know that there's a lot of other areas, family consumer science, health, industrial, cabinet making, all the other people have. It was a really good conference. I don't have anything, so we'll move to anything else. We'll move to administrative reports. We'll start with Mr. Berger.
School's gone pretty well the first 4 days of this week. Anthony Rollins
No discipline issues.
So far we haven't had any of those. So getting ready for enrollment, I guess, on the 17th. Working on schedules and editing things, you know, stuff. I want to get some stuff into Acacia.
When is it the volleyball nets and stuff come in?
Yeah. That kind of depends on who you ask. I think, Dr. Kimber, were you going to reference that?
Yeah.
I'll wait and ask him that question.
Yeah, it's exciting stuff.
Okay.
He'll fill you in on that. Oh, we are hoping that the bleachers come. You'll probably fill you in on that, too. Yeah, we're hoping that they get here.
Goodness. Will we be ready?
Everything's going okay to this point, other than a couple of items. We're ready for enrollment. And enrollment numbers in 712 right now, probably 152 right now. Yeah. You know, maybe I've heard the same thing. We might have some people moving in, some kids. So.
What was the number at the end of the year?
135.
Okay.
Our sixth grade class at seventh graders is a lot bigger than the class that graduated.
17 seniors went out.
And we have a couple kids we have some new kids. I talked to the family today, a new sixth grader and a new sophomore. And there's a new 10-year-old student. I'm not sure what grade he'll be in. Mm-hmm. And so I've heard some. So roughly 152 is where we're at, 712.
Thank you.
Yep, you bet.
Andrea?
I've learned a lot in the last 4 days. And I've been meeting with teachers' aides, and parents. I have a few more people to go, so I've had a lot of meetings this week just to talk with them about what I need to do for them, just trying to learn the job through them, and I have learned a lot, and Marla has helped me well. Marla, thank you. And I'm feeling pretty good. I'm feeling like there's a lot I still need to get figured out and learn how to do, but I've enjoyed visiting with the teachers and the aides and the parents. Got a lot of information from them. I do not have a total enrollment estimate. Mr. Bergen is kind enough. He's going to help me learn some computer programming things I need to know. I've been more focused just on the numbers in kindergarten and first grade, trying to get a real feel for how many we have in those grades right now, since there has been some questions about, you know, what we're going to do in those grades. I think maybe the good news is it looks like we're getting more students in those grades. It's been interesting, and again, I appreciate the opportunity to learn this job, and
Welcome aboard.
Thank you. Thank you. Oh, I should have written it down. I have one thing that the teachers have been mentioning since we've been talking about library is they are concerned that we don't have a specific person doing elementary library. They have been very open to rearranging their library time schedules since they know that the library is going to be kind of crunched for people to get all the jobs done. But quite a few of them said to me, will someone still read to the kids when we check out? Will we still have that? And in my conversations with Christy, you know, yes, the library's going to work really hard to provide that for the kids. It's a service that the teachers, you know, want to have, and they have talked to me about it. I've had that conversation quite a few times this week, so it is a concern.
Okay. We have calendars that are being printed. They should be here for enrollment. Bleachers, I talked to the vendor, and the bleachers and installers are to be here Monday. And they said if everything goes great,
gonna be, you know, all the in 5 or 6 days, and then if it's a little bit longer, it can be as much as 8 or 9. So it'll still be done. Close to starting going down in practice. It'll be definitely close to start, so. We've been, Tuesday we had buses and vehicles inspected. All of our vehicles that transport kids have to have both a mechanical inspection and then also a safety inspection by the highway patrol, so through that process. You heard air conditioning mentioned. We do have someone who's doing a study on us, study for us on air conditioning, both here in the library. It works, but it's old enough that from time to time, you know, if it goes down, it can be several days and it parks and it fixes and stuff. It's probably not very efficient either, as well as the air conditioning unit that's over the high school office. Problems. Of course, I'm sure there's lots of air conditioning units that have problems. We have 105, 160 feet for that length of time. So, we've completed interviews for our food service vacancy and hope to have offer a position in the next day or two. Next week, we'll be conducting interviews for our part-time nurse position. We currently have 3 candidates for that. We had to do a little bit of repairs on our sign out front, the notice sign in front of the building. It's covered by warranty. There's one of the wood parts failed, so they had to replace it. And then the 2 fun things last week. Mr. Brogan started talking about the volleyball. The installer came on Monday for the volleyball and looked at it and said, this won't work. They designed them perfectly fine, but they failed to take into note that we have an air duct that runs down alongside one of our beams. And part of the installation would have to have been installed up into the air duct, which won't work. So they contacted the engineers, and they're looking at how to not be able to do a workaround on that. So it won't affect us in terms of volleyball starting and things like that, because we still have the regular volleyball standards that we can use. So. And the installer said he can come, you know, we work around our schedule and on weekends and stuff like that. So once they figure out how they're going to do the work around on that. And then the last thing that's been interesting, we are having a fence proposed around the practice field. The fence was put in before the city had zoning laws. We should have asked, I guess. We thought that if the fence already exists, all we're doing is essentially put stuff in to replace what's bad. Once you take the wire off, the city views it as being a brand new fence that you're putting in as if it never existed before. So we've got it worked out, but what we had to do was we had to draft a petition requesting the city vacate part of the right-of-way. Otherwise, we would have had to move the east side of the fence in about 17 feet and the north side about 19 feet. That's how big the right-of-way is for the road. So, but they've been cooperative in working with us, and so I met, presented that stuff to the city council meeting last night, and so they actually told us that we can go ahead and we have to have a publish notice and wait 20 days and have a hearing that they actually told us we'd go ahead and start if we want to. I don't know if I want to do that. I don't want to have everything signed and bodied before we progress on it. So that was kind of those 2 things kind of made for an interesting week between the volleyball and the fence. So, that, as I mentioned, the bleachers, I've checked on them twice. And they're either in the
Executive session.
10 minutes. schools.
This I knew we request to be kept in session for 3 minutes. Not special, no matter. I guess we can set it. So, the two principals.
Second part of the executive session with 10 minutes for personal matters with administration. All in favor, right hand. Close, same sign. Shut up. There will be resignations, contracts.
Mr. President, I would entertain a motion to accept the resignation we received from Jill Steinitz as assistant junior high girls basketball coach. Accept that with regrets. She's provided a lot of years of great service for things.
Mr. President, I'm going to accept the resignation. Jill Steinitz, assistant junior high basketball coach.
Second. Been a second to approve the resignation of Jill Steinitz from junior high basketball assistant coach. All in favor, right hand. For the same sign, 7-0.
But also present for approval Connie Clausen as assistant junior high volleyball coach.
So moved.
Second.
And then second to approve Connie Clausen as junior high assistant volleyball coach. All in favor, right hand. For the same sign, 7-0.
Under future agenda items for the September board meeting, hoping the board would be willing to look at a discussion in terms of the superintendent's position. What direction does the board want to go in terms of possibly pursuing sharing the superintendent in another district? Do we want to continue to have a full-time superintendent here? Exclusive to St. John, if so, looking at timelines for the research.
And possibly a special board meeting to approve the budget on
the 22nd. Is that
the 22nd?
Three weeks.
So 7 o'clock work, or would you rather have it 8 o'clock? Not a special meeting. 9 o'clock.
I think
the hell does that work? Can you have them later?
We can do them in the morning as well.
Might be cutting corn that morning.
Cutting corn.
What corn?
corn that's left out the field after swathing.
Carla, what time food you?
I could be like swathing any time.
Just leave it at 7 p.m. That need be.
So we'll set the hearing for 7, and then immediately following the hearing, we'll have to convene for a very short board meeting to accept the budget as
Sorry.
Mr. President, I'm
sorry. And then we adjourn. All in favor, please leave.